بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome everyone in this new meeting of Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation online CME meetings. Today we are waiting Dr. Zaghloul Gouda to illustrate some of his usual interesting cases in the view of and in the field of difficult vascular access. And as usual, we are expecting this session to be very interesting and one of the most fruitful sessions regarding case illustrations and managing this very difficult dilemma. I would like first to welcome our moderators today, Professor Fatima Fadel, Professor of Pediatric Nephrology, Cairo University, and the Head of Interventional Nephrology Chapter, Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation. And also, we are pleasure today to have Professor Hisham Nabil, Professor of Vascular Surgery, as one of our moderators to share in comments and discussion on the on this topic. Please, Professor Fatina, take the mic and lead the session.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Yasser. Assalamu alaikum. Actually, it's always my pleasure to share the ESMT CME activity organized by dear Professor Yasser Abdel Hamid. And I would like to thank him very much for always thinking about the activity of the interventional nephrology chapters and always giving us the chance to present part of this activity. It's also my honor to share this meeting with our dear Professor Hisham Nabil. Professor Hisham is a professor of vascular surgery, Cairo University. He has been leading the vascular surgery team in our hospital, Abu Rish Cairo University Hospital, Children Hospital, for more than 15 years now, and he still present with us, offering his services. He's in solving the problems related to the vascular access of the small children in our hospital. My honor is also to introduce actually one of the most skilled and eminent doctors in the field of interventional nephrology, Dr. Zaghloul Gouda. Consultant of nephrology, the Manhoor Teaching Hospital. Actually, Dr. Zaghloul is always there to find solution out of the box for the very difficult cases of difficult vascular access. And also, I would like to thank him for learning the young generations through the different workshops and the educational courses that he always organized. Thank you very much, Dr. Zaghloul. And he's going to speak about difficult dialysis vascular access, case-based discussion, nephrology experience. Please, Dr. Zaghloul, waiting for your presentation.
Assalamu alaikum. At the start, I would like to thank the Egyptian Society of Nephrology for giving me the chance to be here with you to speak about an interesting topic for me. I would like to thank Professor Yasser Abdel Hamid for his support for this CME meeting. And I am happy to be moderated with Professor Fatina Fadel, the chairman of our interventional nephrology chapter, and with Professor Hisham Nabil. He's one of the eminent and highly experienced professors in the field of vascular access regarding the modalities of vascular access. I would like to thank my colleagues in the Egyptian Interventional Nephrology Chapter for their work and spreading education, and chaired by Professor Fatina Fadel. I would introduce all thanks to the staff members of the Manhoor Nephrology Department for their support and to lead me the chance to be here with you And a special thanks to our nephrology department nursing staff for their support to our patient. My agenda is, I will start by my objective and overview for the number of end-stage renal disease patients all over the world. I will, in Harry, mention some clinical tips which presented in the last presentation for me, and the causes of a challenging vascular access, possible solutions for this challenging access, and case-based discussion. And I will select one approach for insertion of hemodialysis catheter to speak about it, and finally my own message. My objective is to invite every nephrologist to analyze the problem of vascular access in his or her dialysis unit and the plan for intervention, presenting some tips in hemodialysis catheter insertion, and my target is the young nephrologist, and presenting the available local interventions which can be done for a challenging vascular access according to our resources and our needs. Also open discussion for one of the selected approaches. Our case-based discussion, I will start by case one, 36 years old male patient on regular hemodialysis for 1 year with failed bilateral arteriovenous fistula, referred to us for insertion of tunnel decaved catheter. Right internal jugular tunnel decaved catheter was inserted successfully with good blood flow. Post insertion X-ray was altered, but not done, as this patient at the end of the list of this day. Patient returned after 5 days with tunnel cuffed catheter dysfunction. We ordered first the chest X-ray and found the catheter tip here. Your diagnosis, your plan. As I discussed with Professor Fatina, we will delay discussion at the end of the presentation to save time. But I will give some seconds without any comment to do brainstorming with the audience. Before speaking about this, as you know, there is a high increase in the rate of number incident patients of end-stage renal disease worldwide, which may approach for about 4 million currently. And they require well-functioning vascular access. As per KDOQI guidelines, we should individualize the end-stage kidney disease by plan and start vascular access plan for progressive CKD and when the estimated GFR between 15 to 20. Through regular review and the update of the data of the patient and the documentation on the patient file, and it should be done regularly annually. Birkiduki also, it is a multidisciplinary team approach, not the patient or the doctor, but it is the patient, the nephrologist, the radiologist, and the vascular surgery team to do the most suitable plan for this patient regarding vascular access plan. This is the most available vascular access arteriovenous fistula, arteriovenous graft, and central venous catheter, and no ideal access. A lot of limitations for every access, as you know, and this is not the situation for us today. Regarding the history of hemodialysis catheter, it started by the first catheter by Professor Schaldo in 1961. And this is Professor Mahuka, 1986, who developed the double lumen catheter. Regarding some clinical tips today for central venous catheter, first rule, do no harm of the patient. Informed consent, coagulation profile, septic screen, and the pre and the post insertion X-ray. Urgent cases not for training. Ask for help if more than 3 blind trial to access the vein was failed. Also, in urgent hemodialysis situation, insert a temporary hemodialysis catheter, and femoral line is the most suitable. Tunnel decaved catheter insertion is a major operative procedure, not a bedside procedure. We should adhere to infection control. Also, use ultrasound, either pre-scan examination or real-time approach. As you know, from this Cochrane search, there is using ultrasound-guided insertion of catheter decreased the rate of complications by 71%. Let me to review the anatomy of our vascular system prepared by Dr. Hazim Abu Shusha, my colleague in the Manmur Nephrology Department. And this is the right internal jugular, right external jugular, right subclavian, right innominate, left internal jugular, left internal, left subclavian, and the left innominate superior vena cava, and the right. Every nephrologist must be oriented by this anatomical landmark before insertion in the catheter. And this is the catheter in the right internal jugular vein, and this is the catheter tip that is in the left internal jugular vein, and this is in the X-ray. Birki-Duki guidelines, the catheter tip should be in the mid of right. The catheter tip should be within the right atrium, as you see in this imagination. Prevention of hemodialysis catheter dysfunction starts from insertion of the catheter by applying or adherence to the rule of 3 T's. The first T is the tip. The catheter tip should be located in the center of the right atrium, as you see here. And the second T is the top to be not kinked, to be round. And the third T is the tug. Tug means, as you see, when you do aspiration against the closed clamp, it will find no resistance with the blood flow. We adhere in the Manhur to the Manhur algorithm for challenging vascular access, which published in the Journal of Vascular Access. As you find here, we start by scanning of the external jugular veins. If there is obstruction for bilateral obstruction for the internal jugular veins, after that we try low internal jugular vein. After that, check subclavian vein. If there is no chance for insertion of fistula or graft, we proceed. After the option after the subclavian is the femoral vein. After that, we can go to external iliac veins. After that, if failed, we will do refer to the interventional or vascular surgeon. After that, if failed or the patient need urgent indication, retrograde femoral pain, provide a life-saving approach. The most common challenging causes in the Manhur as a sample of Egypt is the pre-dialysis causes. The pre-dialysis causes no available low clearance clinic or multidisciplinary team approach, late diagnosis of patient, no universal health provider, no formal patient education program. When the patient started dialysis, starting dialysis routine primarily non-cavity catheter is available but not inserted for more patients. There is a limitation in the use of arteriovenous graft. If a patient has no chance for fistula. Creation of the arteriovenous fistula, there is a long waiting list, financial issues, as in the private sector, done by non-skilled personnel, limited vascular mapping, pre-operative, and done at the end of the vascular surgeon operative list, diamond become for every list. While post-starting hemodialysis, there is no regular surveillance for the vascular access and inavailability of some vascular intervention like bending and the correction of the aneurysm, which leads to closure most of aneurysm due to inability to do some intervention to save this fistula. The possible intervention is the kidney transplantation BD program, rule of vascular and interventional radiology, regarding screen-guided insertion, angioplasty procedures, hero graft, hybrid arteriovenous stenting, or early cannulation graft, and the transhepatic translumbar approaches. Also the role of nerves, as I will mention in some cases, in the collateral veins, and the bedside life-saving approach, as I will mention in some cases. This is a simulation or graph of early cannulation graft, which the patient can do dialysis in the same day due to the tri-layer of the graft. This is the hyper arteriovenous stenting, and this is the HERO device, as all of us hear about the HERO device, and the role of vascular surgeon from do graft in unusual size, and stenting and the balloon dilatation and so on. Back to our case, what you should for this caster and what is the tip of the caster? We did manipulation for this caster as a caster tip in the azygos vein. And the patient is poor vascular access, so it isn't right to remove the caster and insert the femoral line and so on. But we did a manipulation to a repositioning of the caster tip, as you see. After repositioning, the caster tip is in the right tip. This is an interesting case, and it faced us many times. And Dr. Hazem, our colleague in Damanhur, he is interested by IT working and so on. He did an animation for this procedure. Post procedure, as we don't have the chance to record it in video and so on. As you see, this is the azygos vein for the caster tip passed from the internal jugular to the innominate to here, and the tip is here, not to the, in the right atrium. This is the side view of the azygos vein. And this is the side view of the caster. So the caster tip is directed to the vertebral corner. And this is sure that the caster tip is the azygos vein. This animation from Dr. Hazem to us, the caster is here. He did incision here at the caster inlet and inserted retrograde a guide wire. Then through this, we pulled the caster up. After that, the guide wire is still in place. We introduced a sheath on the guide wire and pulled the guide wire somewhat to be in the innominate vein and redirected the guide, the sheath to be here and the insertion of the guide wire. And after that, cannulation of the caster here. This is an interesting animation by Dr. Hazem, and the caster is finally in the right atrium. So from this case, it is a must to do brainstorming and to solve the problem to the patient, just not to refer. Case 2, 28, 9 years old female patient in the stage renal disease or regular hemodialysis since 8 years. Failed the arteriovenous fistula multiple times, multiple trials for insertion of hemodialysis caster in neck, unfortunately failed. Patient missed at least 2 hemodialysis session. Doppler ultrasound shows bilateral central venous occlusion with clinical signs of superior vena cava obstruction. Tunnel decap the caster inserted in external iliac approach, as you see here. The first question is the caster tip in place. As you know, the caster tip in the IVC either accessed from the femoral vein or the external iliac vein, the caster tip advised to be at the atriocaval angle. And this is ideal position for the caster tip here. The second question, is there any abnormality in the film? Please review the film again. As I said, this patient multiple trial done yesterday before coming to us to insert a caster in the internal jugular vein. And the patient came to us acidotic. We meet the patient in a hurry as the patient missed the hemodialysis for two sessions and also overloaded. But it is must to do pre-insertion X-ray. As you see, it is now clear. The patient has right pneumothorax from the trials of yesterday. So when you insert any catheter for any patient, my message here, good history taking, pre and post insertion X-ray, if you failed to insert a catheter. Also recognize the risk factor for difficult catheterization. Use standard method for catheter insertion. Assistant from experience at hand if you failed from the start. Ultrasound guided procedure is mandatory nowadays, especially with difficult cases. Recognition of complication. It is a must to have high sense of to expect the complication and use standardized algorithm. The third case is a case series of about 5 cases with no vascular access at all. And all of these patients presented to us for CABD in the manhole and from different Egyptian governorates. And all of patients share the same scenario of acidosis, pulmonary edema, severe volume overload, missing dialysis for up to 10 days. You are a nephrologist and you are the final referral center for them. And it is a must to do something for this patient. How to overcome this obstacle? The first case is 55 years old female patient on regular hemodialysis. She was referred to us due to no available hemodialysis vascular access with superior vena cava obstruction, failed the post-femoral vein cannulation. We booked an appointment with the patient for the intervention and radiology. Really, we have no access for him. But the patient is coming for us at the weekend, maybe the Khamis. And to refer to intervention and radiology in Alexandria is Saturday or Sunday. So it is a must to support the patient for that. Patient is acidotic with volume overload and the last session 14 days. How to overcome with no hemodialysis access, even in the ordinary and the non-ordinary sites. The second case is Mr. Nader, 39 years old, in the stage renal disease, recall there is since 2007 history of CABD. Until 2016, he has 4 failed AVF, 4 failed AVG, multiple tunneled and non-tunneled cuff casters, and the transhepatic caster. The patient now is referred to us to provide an access for him. There is signs of severe vena cava, both external iliac vein obstruction. We referred the patient to the interventional radiology, which is an expert in this field, but unfortunately he failed. No available donor for kidney transplantation and refusing to continue in CABD, your vascular access plan. And share the same scenario of the last case. For the first case, our nursing staff inserted for her inflow in the right external jugular vein and the outflow in the collateral veins on the chest due to superior vena cava obstruction. And the patient did two slit hemodialysis catheter, two slit sessions. Every session is 5 hours with good ultrafiltration and the patient is safe. Then we referred the patient to the interventional radiology and inserted by balloon dilatation and the swan tunnel, the cuff catheter, and the patient saved by the skills of our nursing staff. Back to the second case, we find inflow in the right external jugular vein. and outflow in the dilated chest wall veins. And this is the photo of cannulation today. This patient, I take this photo today. Maybe someone of you say this will be a non-efficient dialysis. This isn't optimal dialysis, but this patient is dialyzed through this axis since 2016. So it is 6 years dialyzed by this option. If it is inefficient, he will be died, not to continue 6 years inefficient dialysis. And this patient has an assigned Madame Mona, who will insert for him. Only Madame Mona can insert for him. We have 5 cases referred from different Egyptian governorates, and they came for dialysis from collateral veins. So collateral veins may provide a life-saving and alternative access. Case 4 is a strange case for us and even for the interventional radiologist. She is 65 years old, female patient, end-stage renal disease or regular dialysis, and referred to our interventional nephrology suite for insertion of a temporary catheter due to severe edema of the right arm since 4 weeks, leading to difficult cannulation of the right brachial basilic AVF. Edema since 1 month with edema of the, also of the right lower limb. Started acute since 1 month. There is multiple insertion scars of multiple insertion of central and the femoral catheter, and there is severe edema of right upper limb and the right lower limb, coincident together. Also dilated collateral veins on the right side of the chest, as you see here. There is severe edema of the right arm and difficult cannulation of the fistula, and at the same time in the right lower limb. The right lower limb occurred without any trial spontaneous edema. We need brainstorming for this case. The lower limb, we didn't find any cause for DVT or swollen limb, lower limb. But for the right upper limb, there is dilated collateral veins on the right side of the chest wall. We expected there is a stenosis or acute obstruction of the right innominate vein. So we referred the patient to the interventional radiology, and we refused to insert a catheter, as may he do interventional radiology procedure for the innominate vein, which will cause for resolution of the edema. So we referred the patient to the interventional radiology. The finding is the right innominate vein obstruction and the right external iliac vein obstruction. The plan of the interventional radiology is to do balloon dilatation of the right innominate vein. But he advised the no action for the right external iliac vein due to many causes. The first is the added cost, as this is a private intervention. Here, I would like to thank الجمعية المصرية لرعاية مرضى الكلى لأنها supported this patient by 27,000 Egyptian cells. Also, there is a higher rate of recurrence of reobstruction if we did balloon dilatation. And this is a freely mobile area, so it isn't advised to put a stent in the external iliac vein. Dr. Hisham, can you comment on this interventional radiology procedure? We have an obstruction for the right innominate vein, and the interventional radiology introduced the guide wire and then the balloon, as you hear. After that, there is inflation of the balloon as I know. And finally, the flow regained for in the innominate vein. And as you see, there is disappearance of the collateral circulation, which is present here. This graph, this means successful intervention by balloon dilatation and so on, but no stent done for this patient. Any more comment from you, Dr. Hisham?
No, I think this is the optimum.
Okay.
Can you hear me? Prof.
Yes, yes, Prof, I hear you.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. After that,
But I would like furtherly to ask, from where did he gain the access?
The interventional radiology not in our unit. We referred the patient for him in Alexandria.
Okay, thank you.
So the most details of the intervention I did in.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And we planned for after 2 days, there is complete resolution of the right upper limb edema and the good function of the arterial venous fistula, as you see. And the patient is saved without any more insertion of temporary catheter. What is unexpected? There is something unexpected. We planned to prescribe anticoagulation for the lower limb edema and so on. But there is simultaneous complete resolution of the right lower limb edema after the intervention with the resolution of the edema of the upper arm. This is also strange for me and strange for the radiologist also. But we said this may be due to collateral circulation and so on. Dr. Hazem, our colleague, find this diagram. As you see here, this is the azygos vein, who is a collateral circulation for the external iliac vein, and the drain, up to my knowledge, in the right innominate vein. So correction of obstruction in the right. And the right innominate vein leads to complete resolution of the edema, which is drained by collateral circulation due to obstruction, chronic obstruction of the external iliac vein. And this was strange for us. Case five, this case is done in our department yesterday, 52 years old, long-standing, regular hemodialysis referred to us from Kena. He has chronic hypotension, 19 over 50. The hemodialysis vascular access history failed for ABF due to severe chronic hypotension. ABG not done due to the severe hypotension, multiple tunnel decap decaster in the internal jugular veins, right femoral vein tunnel decaster due to obstruction of both internal jugular veins, and referred to us due to failed left brachiocephalic ABF this week. Referral, he is referred for us to insert the tunnel decap decaster. Bedside Doppler ultrasound, there is obstruction of both internal jugular veins, patent right femoral and the right external iliac veins, thrombosed left external iliac vein, but there is patency of left external jugular vein. As you see, this is a photo for the left external jugular vein. Per our organism, the Manhur algorithm, when there is obstruction of bilateral internal jugular vein, first of all, check external jugular vein. If external jugular vein is more than 5 millimeters, which is the diameter of the cavity hemodialysis catheter, try to insert cav decaster. If succeeded, okay. If failed, try low innominate vein or low internal jugular vein. So we applied this approach on the left internal jugular vein. We insert, we cannulated the external jugular vein here at its lower end.
One minute, Dr. Zaghloul, the slides fixed.
We cannulated the external jugular vein, but cannulation of external jugular vein has a special experience as if you cannulate, it is easier to the guide wire to go to the axillary vein, not to the central vein. So like that, and the caster will be like that. So we advise or recommend to do elevation of the ipsilateral shoulder when you cannulate the external jugular vein to let the guide wire go in one direction to the innominate vein, as you see. After that, we take our measure and the position of the caster tip here. We did the tummy. We dilated by the up to dilators and so on, and to the by the tip of the caster sheath. From my experience, I didn't use the sheath to introduce the caster, especially on the left side. Left side, as you see, there is multiple directions for the caster and the multiple curves to the course of the caster. And especially we use the mid combo, which is a stepped caster. Stepped caster, it is easier to cannulate the caster on the guide wire with the stiffener, like here. We didn't just dilate it by the sheath and then cannulated the caster over the guide wire, like that here. And finally, we did the tug, as you see. Finally, this is the X-ray, as we expected, without the screen, and recorded in our record as the external jugular vein left side and inserted yesterday. And this is my assistant, Madam Sa. This is the last case. Sorry for to be more cases today. This is the last case. The history is 67 years old. Female patient in this stage renal disease on CABD in our department due to new vascular access. Patient presented to us with severe metabolic acidosis and volume overload due to malfunction of input caster since 1 year. Vascular access history, there is bilateral occlusion of internal jugular veins, subclavian veins, distal femoral veins, and external iliac veins, in addition to history of severe vena cava obstruction. Our action, all trials is to flush the caster were failed. She need urgent renal replacement therapy, whatever PD, whatever hemodialysis, until planning with surgery department to explore and manipulate the caster. Firstly, we planned for insertion of temporary PD caster to relieve pressure in the abdomen and to do ultrafiltration. Trials for Doppler guided insertion of temporary access vein. We need an emergency action plan for this patient. We are lucky by during urgent Doppler ultrasound, there is patency and the congestion of the femoral vein proximal to the distal occlusion. There is only occlusion of the distal part of the femoral vein at its insertion with external jugular, external iliac vein. So we did brainstorming why we don't insert the caster retrograde. As you know, the femoral vein is a valvular vein. You can't cannulate the caster retrograde. So we expected due to this is the caster inserted for the patient, CABD caster, as you see here, and the caster was inserted here. The caster on the right side with blood flow rate 250, inserted for 2 days, two slit hemodialysis sessions done with no short-term complication, think of catheter manipulated and restarted CAD. Regarding the retrograde femoral approach, it is published 2014 in the Journal of Vascular Access, and as you see here, and considered by the journal as a new approach, as this is the first time to be reported in the literature. This is the NANCAP. In 2018, I received an invitation from an association in USA. They are preparing for a textbook innovation in dialysis vascular access, and I invited to do to write a chapter about the retrograde femoral vein. But here we inserted cuffed hemodialysis catheter in the retrograde femoral approach. As you see, this is a photo of non-cuffed. This is for the cuffed hemodialysis catheter. My approach philosophy: if you have the femoral vein here is a competent vein, you can't insert the catheter from up and down due to the varices in the vein. And the vein here, as you see, is competent. But what about if we did obstruction to the external iliac or the end of the femoral vein? We expect the vein will be there is varicosity in the distal vein, as there is no DVT, but there is distal obstruction. So the valve will be incompetent, as you see here. And this is the flow rate of blood in normal vascular system from the deep system and the veins from the blood flow from the superficial system to the deep system. What about if there is incompetent veins? Like here, the blood will be directed from the deep system to the superficial system. And to be honest, I did this injection of dye in the femoral catheter. As you hear, in the retrograde femoral catheter, and we find there is a lot of collateral veins, there is obstruction and mild streaks of blood in the external iliac vein, and there is direction of blood from the deep system to the superficial system. And this is our philosophy in this approach. It is indicated, as I said, when there is no access only, and there is no DVT in the ipsilateral femoral vein, and there is an urgent situation to save the life of this patient. As a contraindication, if there is a deep vein thrombosis in the femoral vein, this is the technique. The patient presented in the anti-trend Lindbergh position, as you see here, to do more congestion on the lower limb. And the operator stand on the opposite side. His face is facing the feet of the patient, not the head of the patient, as in the usual femoral vein approach. And we need no guided ultrasound, just by localization, by cannulation of the syringe and guided by the syringe. And we introduce about mostly 15 centimeter of guide wire is enough. We introduce only 10 centimeter of the 15 centimeter catheter, as the long of the superficial femoral vein is 17 centimeters. So we need to introduce only 10 centimeters to be in the main bulk of the vein. And this is a photo of and the plain X-ray of cuffed hemodialysis catheter. We use Amicast 24 centimeter catheter. We bought a strategy and the philosophy to facilitate the guide wire. Manipulate the guide wire gently, straightening the J shape, ask the patient to do mild contraction and relaxation of the side. As this may be, if tolerated, may be facilitate the introduction of the guide wire. If there is difficulty to introduce at least more than centimeter, the procedures. As you see, this is multiple X-ray for multiple patients. Our team. And this is the case series. There is no time. You can find in the literature to read the outcome of this patient. And we did a post-insertion care hospitalization to minimize movement and the castor tip displacement, broad-spectrum antibiotic, applying mepirocin cream, prophylaxis against DVT, assign an expert nursing staff to deal with the castor, and I added measures to increase the hemodialysis adequacy through decreasing the recirculation. We بنبدل الازرق مكان الاحمر والاحمر مكان الازرق. As we are introducing the catheter against the blood flow, increase hemodialysis session, select is mandatory for this patient, increase pump speed and the daily hemodialysis until referral of the patient. There is no considerable complication. The duration is 1 to 2 days in our patient. My conclusion for retrograde femoral approach, it is a life-saving short-term approach for patients with poor vascular access. It necessitates the patency of the superficial femoral vein. It saves the time until referral to a higher level of care to provide an alternative hemodialysis access. It saves the time until manipulation and of the BD catheter if there is a problem with the CBD. It can be done successfully in a satellite center. My colleague, Dr. Ahmed in Luxor, he heard about this approach and defined a case and inserted the catheter and saved the patient in Luxor by this approach. Finally, as you know, early referral of the patient when the GFR is 30 for the vascular surgeon and the multidisciplinary team approach is mandatory. And when the GFR is 15, start to create the vascular access plan and create an alternative vascular access plan for the patient. My access, my life, and I would like to thank you for your attention and for this long presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Zaghloul, for this highly illustrative and very interesting session. And these very difficult cases.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed how you managed these cases. Quite a rich and important and safe access.
Yeah.
Professor Fatina?
Yes, thank you very much, Dr. Zaghloul, for this presentation. Actually, as I have said, you always find solutions out of the box. It's really, really incredible. Yeah, and you find the access for patients who, everyone would think that there is no solution for them. So thank you very much. And thank you for transmitting your experience for all the audience and for the young generations, giving them the hope that we have to go after the patient for, يعني انت بتفضل ورا العيان فعلا يعني هنركبه هنلاقي له يغسل هنلاقي له يغسل فيعني بشكرك جدا فعلا دكتور زغلول على شغلك يعني حاجه outstanding فعلا وبايونير في حته يعني حاجات بقى ريكورد باسمك وكده فيعني بشكرك جدا فعلا ربنا يكرمك يعني برزنتيشن هايله وطبعا I would like to hear from Professor Hisham هو معانا يعني شاف معانا برضو حالات كتير صعبة في الأطفال خصوصا كده فبرضو his experience طويلة جدا معانا يعني نشوف بقى رأيه في البرزنتيشن وفي الشغل وفي ممكن يفيدنا بعد كده ازاي في كل الفيلد بتاعنا
Thank you, Dr. Fatina, for the nice talk about me. And I really admire the valuable work of Dr. Zaghloul. But I have some comments for about the whole talk about the femoral vein cannulation. Of course, we all know that it should be avoided as much as possible. And if we have to do a femoral vein cannulation, we can start by using the left femoral vein so as to leave the patient a chance if he's going to be transplanted, because we usually do the first transplantation on the right side. And we have lots of femoral catheters inserted in patients, maybe for the first time of dialysis, neglecting the rule of we have to insert in the right jugular first, then the left jugular, then the subclavians, then the femoral in the last. We find so many cases. The first catheter to be inserted was a right femoral. We should try in our transmission of information to decrease the insertion of femoral catheters. And we also should avoid the insertion of catheters by a blind technique. We should use an ultrasound, we should use a C-arm, and I know Dr. Zaghloul had stressed upon these. One more thing, that the subclavian catheters usually should be done in the arm of a failed fistula, because if this patient will do a fistula later on and having a subclavian catheter, usually it will lead to stenosis and will lead to edema and failure of any try of arteriovenous fistula. As for the novel technique, I really admire it. It is very durable and nice, especially in cases which are having no other alternatives. But I cannot see that we can extend dialysis on this novel procedure. It can be used, of course, in the acute conditions. And if we have no tools, like doing a CTV first or trying to balloon dilate the central venous system, we can, of course, try this novel technique. But I think on the long term, this patient will suffer from recirculation, because the caliber of the femoral veins is not that big enough, and it doesn't share the circulation with the other body parts. So the recirculation and the efficiency of dialysis will be affected. I would like to try to share my screen to show you some.
I would like to mention something, Professor Schmidt. Retrograde femoral approach is for 1 or 2 days only.
And I think this is optimum.
Yeah.
And I think this is very optimum. I'm trying to, I think I couldn't share WhatsApp photos.
You can share a screen, make share a screen and make it your screen. Choose share a screen وخليه هو اللي على الديسكتوب.
Yeah, I'm trying to. Cases of inserted permicathis, because I have some modifications which maybe I would like to present in another meeting. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you a lot. Thanks a lot. Excuse me to ask you a question, please. Do you feel of the cases Dr. Zaghloul illustrated to us today that there is one of them can have a surgical solution easier than what he did, or nothing else to be done except what his solutions?
There are two categories of patients.
Yes.
A patient which can be a candidate for an easy Tesla. This patient should have good veins and should have a proper blood pressure. Usually, the patients referred to catheter therapy having low blood pressure. And
yes.
and this is the cause of repeated fistula failure. So once patient has a catheter for dialysis, this means that he's not a candidate for an easy fistula. So central veins gets exhausted by time. And we do routine balloon dilatation to the subclavian and the innominate veins and the jugular. And usually there is a high rate of restenosis. And we do something like balloon dilatation every 6 months or every year. But there is no available surgeries so far. And in Egypt, we have a very bad reputation for AV grafts. And the rate of infection is quite high. Maybe the hero graft would solve this cases if it's available in Egypt. But up till now, it's not yet available.
Okay.
What about the AV cannulation graft?
In Egypt, due to our hygiene and due to our weather, it really infects fast, and this multiple layers are hosting more bacteria than the ordinary graft due to our weather, due to humidity, due to our hygiene. So it's not really a durable solution in Egypt.
We have some questions. We have some questions in the chat from Dr. Muhammad Ahmed Mustafa. He is asking about
the role. Do you use for estimating the length
depth of insertion of an internal jugular vein catheter, either the right or left side? Thanks.
For determination of the caster tip, all casters should have its tip in the right atrium. So we have two options for estimating the length of the caster. We put the tip of the caster at the mid sternal point. We estimate the start and the end of the sternum, and put the tip at the sternal mid sternal point, and draw the caster until the point of insertion of the guideway. This is one. The second one is the sternal angle, and put the caster tip 2 centimeters below the sternal angle on the right side of the sternum. And if there is a female, we can lead the tip more depth by 2 centimeters, as caster tip retraction will be done when standing due to the breast weight.
Okay.
Excuse me, sir. Are you talking about insertion without a C arm?
Without a C arm. We don't, as a nephrologist, we don't have CR. We insert the blind. We have only Doppler ultrasound. We aren't a vascular to have a lot of this facility.
Okay, and we can also judge the catheter, is it placed in a right position or not, by trying to aspirate with a 20 centimeter syringe, which mimics the action of the hemodialysis machine.
Yeah.
So if the flow in and out is smooth and nice, This means that the position of the catheter will be good. And sometimes even if the catheter placed under C-arm in the beginning of the right atrium, which is about the third intercostal space, sometimes still the catheter doesn't work good with the syringe. So we have to make more length of the catheter inside the heart.
So as you see, Professor Sharif, this is what name does attack. As you see here, aspiration against the closed clamp, and when you do a high negative pressure in the syringe, the same, which is similar to the blood pump speed of the machine, and when you relieve pressure of the clamp, you will get a good flow. This is a good sign that the catheter tip is located in the mid of the right.
Yes, exactly. That's what I'm trying to say. Thank you.
Okay.
Another question from Dr. Ibrahim Sayed. For some difficult and urgent cases, what is about arterial cannulation for saving life? And he mentioned that he tried it successfully in some patients, both brachial and femoral. Also, for retrograde cannulation, I tried it once for external jugular vein and also superficial chest wall veins. Okay. Thank you for your experience. And he's asking about arterial cannulation for saving life.
I can't do arterial cannulation, but done with once with me wrongly, but I didn't intend to cannulate the artery. But the patient, no access, and the dialysis is life-saving for him. And we aspirated only from the artery and did venous return of the machine in the arm vein. As if we have a clot in the machine or in the blood line and enters the artery, will cause acute ischemia for this lower vein. And it is mandatory to remove the catheter from the artery as early as possible due to there is severe venous arterial spasm of the artery, may cause ischemia also.
Professor Hisham,
Professor Yasser, I remember once that Professor Hisham Nabil himself was in one of the centers of Upper Egypt several years ago. You remember Hisham?
Yes.
He went, and he came to us very astonished, and he explained how he was astonished that they used to cannulate the artery. The nurses there it was a university center, a big university center with a lot of patients, and he came describing that what happened, and he saw many patients with arterial cannulation, and actually he commented on this. And we can get the experience from him. You can comment on this, Professor Hisham, please.
It's in common practice that some experienced nurses, when a patient had a closed fistula, okay, the fistula doesn't have a flow, but the artery, the brachial artery after the fistula is very superficial and can be palpable. So they used to puncture it. And as Dr. Zaghloul said, they return the blood in a peripheral arm vein. And this is very common practice in many parts of Egypt. As the fistula is already closed, so they use the brachial artery as the inflow, and they have a peripheral vein cannula to return the blood. And I don't think it that risky. The brachial artery is artery of a good reputation. We fear only infection. Infection can cause secondary hemorrhage, which may be fatal to the patient. But puncturing the brachial artery as a life-saving procedure once, I don't think it's a crime. But of course, the femoral artery is obsolete, and it can cause catastrophes. Thank you.
Excuse me for this question, but I need to know an answer. Do you use the artery for the in and outflow, or also for, or only for the outflow?
No, only for the outflow. And then the vein in a peripheral vein, in a peripheral artery vein.
Yes, to be clear for this point, only for the outflow, not for
I stressed they do the outflow from the closed fistula through the brachial artery.
Okay. And this technique was used for the in CRRT, I think the arterial puncture.
Clearly. Yes.
Yeah.
Here the techniques were
common use. Yes.
And in the ICU usually, and in the anesthesia procedures, we usually the cannulation of the arterial cannulation is now, our invasive monitoring is now encouraged better than usual cases of monitoring using arterial cannula.
It needs experience, special care, prevention of complications that might occur, taking care of this, not to be used for long. I mean, if, as the Professor Hisham has said, if it just wants to critical situation, it would be accepted, yes.
As a bailout solution, it can be done once the brachial artery is not that dangerous. And also we can apply good compression in contrary to the femoral. The femoral compression is not that easy.
Yes.
Okay. Let me take this point to ask Dr. Zaghloul a question to stress on the landmarks for retrograde femoral, Dr. Zaghloul. Do you use the usual landmarks for femoral cannulation or other landmarks to know the exact size?
It is about 2 centimeters. Lose a case, but one of our case series.
Excuse me, 2 centimeters. What?
Below the crease, the crease in the thigh.
I think it is the same place for the usual cannulation of femoral vein.
The same place, but 1 to 2 centimeters below, and okay. Sometimes we cannulate the vein about 5 centimeters Doppler guided as there is obstruction lower than the distal end of the femoral.
Okay.
I have a question, Dr. Zaghloul, please.
Fadda.
I'm Dr. Karamuzian. There is one patient before we inserted for him left jugular. But after X-ray, we found the catheter in inferior vena cava. From left internal, the catheter was very long. Long catheter. But the catheter, after X-ray, we found the catheter in inferior vena cava. But the catheter was well, in working well. We was in a disturbance, so we should remove the catheter or we can leave the catheter. We removed the catheter, yeah, because this is first time to happen with us. What's your opinion?
I have one case like that, but we discovered this case after interventional radiology inserted the catheter for a patient. And I contacted the interventional radiology, and finally we agreed to leave the catheter in place. But one issue I wanted to mention here is the catheter, the blood flow in the catheter here in the IVC, it is against the blood flow, not like if the catheter is in the middle of the right atrium. So it is a must to reverse the blood flow like here, as if you did blood venous return in the catheter tip. You will do suction and decrease the rate of recirculation and recirculate the blood in the arterial side of the catheter. So from my mind,
we should
reverse the blood flow in the catheter.
Okay.
I would like to add that an IVC catheter is well accepted. And sometimes there is a patient with a permacath for something like 2 or 3 years. And we start to
see that the catheter is getting less and less flow. This may be due to a fibrin sheath. Okay, of course, we all know what's a fibrin sheath. So I have to put a longer catheter to get out of this fibrin sheath. So eventually I can place a longer catheter in the cava, and this is well accepted.
Thank you. Professor Faisal Shaheen wants to comment.
Yes, thank you, Prof. I enjoyed the talk, and I'm sure that we still need the extension of this talk to know more complication about clotting of the catheter and taking care of the catheter, and some more difficult case when we have a patient who had thrombosis every now and then, and we cannot reach access, how we can help them. I'm sure that our colleague have expert in such a very difficult case, which can help our new colleague also to deal with such a difficult case and dialysis, especially if we don't have transplantation program and the patient have previous operation in the abdomen, so you can't put him in BD, so you left only to dialyze him. Myself, I have few cases recently which is very difficult, was very difficult to put for them any line because of severe hyperkalemia to be dialyzed urgently. But being managed by one of our radiologists also to keep one catheter in for dialysis, but not for long, because we have to find solutions for such patients. So I'm sure such scenario of patients can happen everywhere, that no access, no BD, no transplant, and we have to save the patients. Maybe something intra-abdominal that can be surgically inserted in order to save the patients. And it is also complicated and difficult to be done. So I am sure that we will need more about vascular access, especially, again, how to take care of the access, hygiene of the access, either the solution which keep the access free of infection and clots, without mentioning the name. There are many now, and I think I enjoyed the talk, and I hope that we can have extension of this talk to another one wider about what I request. Thank you very much, Prof.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Faisal. We have another case series of catheter malfunction, and how as a nephrologist can deal with these catheters, especially most of patient access is precious for them or difficult access. So it is a must to solve the problem and treat malfunction. We can do presentation in the future, inshallah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Faisal. Professor Fatina, we have two more questions on the chat.
Okay.
From Dr. Ibrahim Sayed, asking about cannulation of the superficial temporal artery in very difficult urgent cases. Yeah. About your experience, if you have any, in this issue?
I don't have any.
Superficial idea. Artery? Sorry, Dr.
Temporal. Temporal artery. He said that he tried it many times. He said that he tried it many times without complications. Don't think.
He can tell us about his experience.
Yes, I will. Please unmute Dr. Ibrahim and tell us about your experience regarding this point.
Assalamu alaikum. والله هو طبعا موضوع الفاسكولار اكسس اتعرضت ليه كتير جدا في حالات يعني ايفن حالات دايد اون تيبل يعني عندنا صغيرين في السن وكده، فكنا بندور على اي وسيله يعني من ضمن الطرق مثلا حاولنا نركب نيدل، مش بنركب مثلا كان الضفائر ده نيدل مثلا هي من 22 نركبها على السوبرفيشال تمبرال ناخدها كارتريال لاين ونوصلها على المكن ونرجع على اي بريفرال فين. دي كانت احدى الطرق اللي عملتها وكانت يعني في بعض الحالات يعني ايه قدرنا نعمل سيفرال سيشنز بيها. بعض الحالات الثانيه حاولنا نعمل برضو البنكشر للبريكيال وبنكشر للفيمورال ارتري كارتيريال لاين بنيدل مش بقسطره، ده بنيدل كده بنيدل ومش نيدل مثلا 16 ولا 8 بنيدل مثلا 2 نيدل 20 مثلا وبنوصلها وفي اخر الجلسه كده بنعمل كومبريشن والجلسه تكمل ايه كويس. الحل اللي كانت اصعب من كده خالص اللي ما كانش لاقين لها اي طريقه خالص والعيان فيري كريتيكال وبقاله برضو اسبوع او اكتر من اسبوع ما غسلش، اضطريت ان انا وعنده الاكسس كلها اكزوست اضطريت ان انا فتحت 2 سنتيمتر او 3 سنتيمتر على الفيمورال اريا، لقيت الاريا الاستنوتيك او الاريا الفيبروتيك اللي مش عارفين ندخل فيها خالص لوكالايزد، وبعد كده المور بروكسيمال الفين ديامتر بتاعه كويس ما فيهوش في اي مشكله، ركبت له القسطره كحاجه سيرجيكال يعني ركبت له قسطره فيمورال فوق الحته اللي كانت فيها فيبروزس واستنوتيك وكملت يعني وقعت القسطره فتره طويله فيه. فهو ده كانت بعض الايه يعني الاكسبيرينسز اللي كانت ايه معايا.
طب السؤال يا دكتور ابراهيم، هو السوبرفيشال تيمبرال ارتري كانيوليشن البلاد فلو ريت بيبقى كام ولا دولت بيدياتريك ولا ادلت؟
لا لا ده كانوا ادلت تمام. كان فلو مثلا يعني افريج 200 ممكن مثلا 180 ولكن يعني بيتر ذان ناثينج، احنا في حاله اساسا جوينج تو داي تمام وحصلت معانا اكتر من مره للاسف، يعني واحد عمل ترانسبلانت وفيلد وبريتونيال كله ادهيجنز وكل الاكسس الفاسكولار اكسس اكزهوستد وفي الاخر مات دمنا وانتبه مش قادرين نعمل له حاجه، فهتبقى سو بينفول ان احنا بنحاول نعمل لايف سيفنج على حساب يعني كومبليكيشن ممكن تحصل بس هتبقى يعني بيتر ذان ديث تمام. فسوبرفيشال تيمبرال ارتري استخدمته في بعض بنعمل شيفنج للاريا بتاعت التيمبرال ارتري ونحاول مثلا كده في بوزيشنز معينه ان هو يكون مثلا زي ترند لينجبرج مثلا نحاول نعمل كومبريشن من اي ناحيه بحيث نعمل نشوف الاريا اللي احنا نقدر ندخل فيها وتجيب لنا فلو كويس بنيدل مش يعني بنيدل فاين نيدل مش نيدل كبيره تمام وبنوصلها على الارتري وبتكمل ايه للاخر تمام. فهو برضو يعني ممكن اكون انا اجريسيف شويه مثلا في الحالات ديت ولكن احنا في حاله ضعيفه
ولا جراح
نعم لا نفرولوجي
وتفتح الفيمورال 2 سم وتدخل والديسكت يعني ما شاء الله يعني
تمام. طب حضرتك ما عيان باين قدامنا انا كنت
انا بحييك يعني
كان ايزلي سولف if you had an ultrasound it would show the stenotic area and will show the flow above it and then you can easily cannulate if it's opposite to the inguinal ligament a little bit above the inguinal ligament it will be a bit deep but still can be solved with the ultrasound.
Okay, we have a last question in the chat asking about internal jugular catheter inserted from Dr. Mustafa Abdullah. Internal jugular catheter inserted in subclavian and axillary vein. Retrograde, the catheter worked well, discovered accidentally by chest X-ray. Can be a route for urgent dialysis if the arterial and venous lines are changed.
What is that? What cannulation?
I think he's asking that subclavian, as it's cannulated, should we continue or remove?
It's the insertion, I think he means that insertion from the for the internal jugular, and it went to the axillary vein.
Mm.
This is what he means? And he's asking about removing or continuing dialysis from
the catheter. The catheter will only do this if there is an obstruction in the internal jugular vein or the subspurivena cable. So it will be directed towards the axillary.
Oh, and we saw cases like this.
And I saw so many cases, and it can be done for, it can be used for dialysis for one or two sessions, but probably will cause arm edema.
Do you mean to be like that?
Yes.
Yes,
this
I think
it is. Like, Zaghloul, yes.
Yes.
Going into the axillary.
Yeah, yeah. This case occurs mostly when we cannulate the external jugular vein. So if we ask the patient to elevate the ipsilateral shoulder, we will block the axillary vein or subclavian, and the catheter will be directed here to the innominate vein and the superior vena cava.
Okay. Thank you. Professor Fatina, I have no more questions and no more comments.
Thank you very much for this.
Can I have comment, Professor Yasser?
Yeah.
Dr. Ayman.
Professor Ayman.
From Professor Ayman Rifai wants to comment.
Yes, please.
I would like to thank Professor Yasser for choosing this very important and important topic in our daily practice. Thank you, Professor Yasser. Thank you, Professor Fatina, for the excellent and elegant moderation. I'd like to thank and congratulate Dr. Zaghloul. I thank him for the presenting this issue in the form of case scenarios, which is more interesting. I would like to congratulate him for the successful management of such difficult cases. I totally agree with Dr. Hisham in what he said, that we should leave the femoral vein as a large resource, especially the right femoral, not to deprive the patient from the chance of transplantation. Actually, I'm annoyed about using the artery cannulation. There is a lot of complications, whether in the form of bleeding or most serious secondary infection with fatal bleeding. So I think it's not recommended at all to puncture the artery. What we are doing in our difficult cases that we have, thanks to our interventional radiologists, that they have cannulated the IVC successfully for these difficult cases. And this was, at least a bridge until the patient have a transplant. Otherwise, it is safe, as Professor Hisham mentioned. And I think we should have always the help of expert interventional radiologists in our practice, besides, of course, the expert vascular surgeons. Thank you very much. I enjoyed the whole subject and the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comment. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ayman. Professor Fatina?
Yes. Thank you, Professor Ayman, for the comment and for, we have to stress, actually, yes, about not to puncture an artery. This is very important. Yeah, yes. As Professor Hisham said, it could be allowed for once in an emergency situation, but not to be repeated and not to be the regular or the routine work that we go for. This should be notified. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Ayman. Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Dr. Zaghloul, for the very nice presentation. Thank you, Professor Hisham, for sharing us our meeting. Thank you, Professor Yasser, for choosing this important topic. And you close.
Thank you, Professor Hisham, for
thank
being
you.
With
thank
us.
You, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Fatir. Thank you, Professor Zaghloul, for your very interesting cases as usual.
Okay, thank you, Professor. I would like to thank our moderator, Professor Ayman, and I want to forward a message in Arabic, please. يعني أنا يعني لو أنا عندي مريض والمريض ده حضرتك فيه بور أكسس يعني يا ريت المشكلة تكون بتاعتي مش بتاعة المريض وأنا اللي أخد المريض من الأول لحد ما تتحل المشكلة بتاعته حتى إيفن لو أنا المريض أنا مش هعمل له حاجة شكراً.
شكرا دكتور زغلول. Thank you for this very important message.
Please last words, Professor Yasser. As Professor Faisal Shaheen said, I think this could be a series of these such cases in the next meetings. It needs the topic needs to be more covered with such interesting cases with Dr. Zaghloul. I think we can continue this series. We need this, I think.
Sure, sure. Must be considered. Will be considered. In the view of this very interesting session, really one of the most interesting sessions. And I would like to thank you all for your share and for your interactions. And thank especially Professor Hisham, who reached this session with his experience, and Professor Fatina for very, very, very interesting and fruitful moderation and smart moderation. Thank you, Professor Ayman Rifai, Professor Faisal Shaheen, for sharing us. And thank you all our attendees for sharing with their questions, even in the chat, and even also live questions. And excuse me to close this session and announce for the coming one, which will be next Wednesday, 8th of June, Professor Akram Abdelbari will speak about extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, or ECMO, which is the new trend in ICU and the critical care settings that arise very, very, very much as a modality in the COVID area and continues later on. Thank you all, and excuse me to close. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. صباح الخير. شكرا لحضراتكم جميعا.
مع السلامة. باي باي.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. مع السلامة.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. مع السلامة.